Well, good morning, Grace Lutheran Church and School, to our friends and our families and our kids. This is May 24th. We're going to celebrate the Ascension of our Lord this Sunday using Divine Setting 1. We hope our worship is a blessing to you, and we're so glad that you are here. At this time, we will begin with our first musical selection. Make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins unto God our Father. Most merciful God.
We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake, he forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We read our intro it responsively. God has gone up with a shout.
The Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
The Lord says to my soul, sit at my right hand. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind.
You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
The Lord is at your right hand.
He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son.
And to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning.
Is now and will be forever. Amen.
God has gone up with a shout. Kyrie of the Church.
In peace let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Almighty God, as your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, ascended into the heavens, so may we also ascend in heart and mind and continually dwell there with him who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our musical selection.
Thank you.
Our first reading for this Ascension Sunday is from the book of Acts, chapter 1, the first 11 verses. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dwelt with all that Jesus Christ began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. To them he presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." When he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, whom was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our assigned psalm for this Ascension Sunday is Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all peoples.
Shout to God with loud songs of joy.
For the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared.
A great king over all the earth.
He subdued peoples under us.
And nations under our feet.
He chose our heritage for us.
The pride of Jacob.
God has gone up with a shout.
The Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
Sing praises to God. Sing praises.
Sing praises to our King. Sing praises.
For God is a king of all the earth.
Sing praises with a song.
God reigns over the nations.
God sits on his holy throne.
The princes of the peoples gather.
As the people of the God of Abraham.
For the shields of the earth belong to God. Our epistle reading is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, beginning at verse 15. "For this reason, because I've heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are his riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward all of us who believe according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things in the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This too is the word of God." Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus said to them, These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, thus it is written, the Christ should suffer and on a third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you're clothed with power from on high. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple blessing God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Morning, Grace Lutheran Church and School. It's so nice to have you join us here again. Today, we're going to continue talking about Jesus explaining to his disciples what they need to know before he goes to heaven. Now, if you remember from last week, we talked about how Jesus had told them that they were to go and tell people about him, but they had to wait until the special gift that he was sending would come to them. And here he was reminding them that he was going to his Father in heaven and that the gift would come to him and be with them. Now, at first, the disciples were sad that Jesus would be leaving them. But then the Bible tells us that Jesus opened their minds and they were able to understand what amazing things were about to happen. The Bible tells us that Jesus lifted his hands to bless his disciples, and while he was blessing them, he was lifted up and taken up into heaven. I don't know how all of this looked because I wasn't there, but if I think about it, kind of reminds me of when I've had a balloon, and the balloon was filled with helium and I was holding on to it, and then either on purpose or sometimes accidentally, which I'm sure has happened to you, I've let go, and that balloon has risen up into the air and into the clouds. And you can sometimes watch it. You can look up and you can cover your eyes from the sun and watch as it goes up into the sky. And that kind of makes me think about what the disciples did. They were standing there with him as he was blessing them, and then he just lifted up with the clouds into heaven. And they stood there and watched him ascend higher and higher until he disappeared from view. Were the disciples sad? A little bit. But the Bible tells us that when Jesus had gone up into heaven, they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually in the temple praising God, staying where Jesus had told them to wait for the special gift that God was sending them. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus, your only Son, to die for us. We know that he has risen from the dead and has returned to heaven to be with you, and that one day he will come back here to be with us and to take us to be with you. Bless us today as we worship him with great joy, as the disciples did after they watched him return to heaven. In his name we pray, amen.
Above all, nature and all created things.
has ever known. Above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, lay behind the stone. You lay and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Title of our message this morning, The Ascension of Our Lord Means Jesus is Present More Than Ever. It is from the gospel text in Luke chapter 24. Question, what scripture is the greatest comfort to you? No doubt, many of you just answered Psalm 23. But Isaiah 41:10 might also be cited. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, I am your God. In the New Testament, Matthew 11:28 is a great comfort. Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. And one that also ranks very high is the last verse in Matthew chapter 28. Lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. Each of these verses speak to the ever presence of our Lord Jesus. And in the first verse of our ascension text in Luke, Jesus tells the disciples, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you. The glorified Jesus is standing in front of the disciples. He's eating some roasted fish. Their initial response is pure emotion. They are full of fear and terror. Jesus is present, but no longer in the same way as before his resurrection. And so immediately we again see that fact and experience are insufficient for faith. The interpretive word is what begets faith. And if you think back on the revelation experience of the Emmaus Road disciples, it's repeated here in the ascension for all the disciples. Jesus is present, but he's not recognized. Check. He interprets the scriptures. Check. His true identity is recognized, and he disappears. Check. The two Emmaus Road disciples and the whole contingent of disciples here in Luke chapter 24, each in turn returned to Jerusalem full of joy, the fruit of faith. The ascension of our Lord celebrates new beginnings and change. And the first change is the change into disciples of joy. So here, the means of grace again are required for faith, since our natural faculties are corrupted by sin. Sinful man is totally depraved, no matter how much we don't like to admit that. Faith is a matter of grace, not free will, even though we don't like to admit that. Human eyes are blind to the identity of Jesus. Human ears are deaf to his spoken words. Jesus is Savior. He must heal spiritual blindness and deaf ears. And so, again, faith is the work of God, and here it's created by the Holy Spirit through the Word, the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. John 17:8 is the high priestly prayer of Jesus before he's going to the cross. He prays to God the Father for the disciples, and he explains, "I have given the disciples your word, and they received them, and they believed." Hence, Jesus must open the minds of the disciples to understand and trust the objective facts of the gospel, that he is the promised Messiah, that he came to suffer and die and rise again, that he is the way to eternal life. So, after explaining the eternal merits of his death and resurrection, Jesus gives the disciples their marching orders, their mission statement. And he explains the Great Commission of Matthew 28:19, "Go and make disciples of all nations," here in Luke 24, saying, "Preach in his name repentance to the forgiveness of sins to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem." Disciples preach the completed work of Jesus' redemption. Disciples preach the gospel. The death and the resurrection of Jesus are for you by baptism. Disciples preach the repentance of John the Baptist and the forgiveness of Jesus. Disciples preach Jesus as our sacrifice, our substitute, and our peace, who restores a fallen creation to sin by exorcism, by healing, resurrection from the dead, and the forgiveness of sins. The whole Gospel of Luke details the life of Jesus as a journey to Jerusalem, a journey to the cross, a journey much like Jacob's ladder. It starts with the incarnation. From the foundation of the beginning of time, before the foundation, Jesus comes from heaven to earth into the womb of Mary, and he begins his ministry. His crucifixion takes him to the grave, to resurrection. And his ascension that we celebrate this Sunday, his exaltation from earth back to heaven, and the right hand of God. This Exodus is discussed by Moses and Elijah at the Transfiguration, making it the eternal conversation of heaven. Matthew Henry, the great commentator, he views these two natures of Christ in the incarnation as the ladder to heaven. The top of the ladder is his divine nation, his divine nature. The bottom rung is his human nature. And we travel the same Exodus from earth to heaven in our repentance and forgiveness of sins. Repentance starts with the law of God, recognition of our sinful nature, and genuine sorrow that turns away from our sins. Following contrition and confession, the bruised sinner trusts the gospel by faith for the forgiveness of his sins. Why? Because eternal life is not in our hands. It rests in the nail-scarred hands of Jesus. The clearest verse on repentance is Paul in 2 Corinthians 7, verse 10. We see it again. Repentance is not our work. It's the work of God. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. So the message of the ascension, Jesus is present with us. He said, I'll ask the Father and he'll give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit teaches us about Jesus, creates faith, equips us with his power and his gifts in the service of the Word. The Holy Spirit enables us to embrace the body and blood of Jesus in the service of the sacrament. The Holy Spirit transforms disciples from eyewitnesses to ministers of the Word, from fact to faith, from changed persons to persons who change others by sharing the love of Jesus. One of the sins of the church is imitation of the world. Imitation of the world for witness initiatives instead of trusting the power of the Holy Spirit. Our culture is no acquaintance of prayer that acknowledges a dependence on God. Our culture denies a triumphant Christ. Our culture, in its advertising, sings hymns to hamburgers and celebrates the glory of dish detergent. Rather than pursue justice, politicians exploit fear and class jealousies. When we succumb to culture and their norms, we embrace trivial and tragic things with no future. The disciples are powerless to witness, to preach, until clothed with the Holy Spirit of Pentecost. Then these poor fishermen changed the world. We are no different. Ministry is the office of the Holy Spirit, not an imitation of the world. Second sin of the church is indifference to the witness of the world, Word and the Holy Spirit. Worship's not sitting on our hands. Worship responds to the gospel by sharing the good news with our mission field, our family, our friends, those we come into contact with. And the Holy Spirit is given to each of us in different measure at different times. And we see this in the Bible. At Pentecost, he invests the church with the power and the gifts necessary to preach and witness to the gospel. If we consider ourselves incapable of serving and confessing our Lord, we reject and deny the power of the Holy Spirit to change us and the people around us. The ascension of our Lord is the last act of his public ministry. And it is the first time that the disciples will worship him and know him as a resurrected Lord. But the ascension begs a question. How can Jesus be in heaven and earth at the same time? That same question is debated in the real presence of our Lord in Holy Communion. Well, that's a long discussion, but I'm just going to use Jeremiah 23:24 for a defining response, where God says, "Do not I fill heaven and earth?" The themes of divine presence in heaven and earth all coalesce around the ascension. And so the first exodus of Jesus is complete as he is taken to heaven. After the ascension, all that's left to those disciples and to the disciples present here at worship is worship. Jesus has opened the minds of the disciples to the scriptures. He's promised his Holy Spirit. The result of fear and terror are replaced by joy, a fruit of the tree of faith and gift of the Holy Spirit. That is the same joy experienced by the shepherds at the birth of our Lord. That's the same joy celebrated by a fatted calf for the prodigal son. That's the same joy of heaven and earth for the resurrection. That's the same joy of heaven over one sinner who repents. And that's the same joy of faith that we hold in our heart when we know Jesus is with us in his word and his sacraments. How does Luke end his gospel? He doesn't. He introduces a new beginning. That new beginning is the birth of the apostolic church, and that new beginning is the book of Acts. Luke introduces change. After Pentecost, the church and the presence of God are no longer limited to a single location. The Holy Spirit is the presence of God in new and changed ways. Those new ways include the house church, the teaching of the apostles, baptism for the uninitiated, and the Lord's Supper for the initiated. And great joy in those house churches is celebrated in the breaking of bread from house to house daily. And we celebrate that same joy as we gather around his word and sacraments while we look up, waiting to see the Son of Man coming again in a cloud with power and glory. Until then, we too continuously worship Jesus and we witness to his name. Please pray with me. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. At this time, we will make the good confession of faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. prayer of the church. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with a sound of the trumpet. Ascendant Lord, hear the prayers of your people and grant our supplications, that the Lord may grant us all things in Christ so we may be sustained in trial, strengthened in weakness, and delivered from trouble. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the church of Christ may flourish and the good news of Christ crucified, risen, and ascended would be proclaimed to all the ends of the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may richly supply us with faithful pastors who will preach your word in season and out, that we may hear, believe, and live this gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the nations of the earth may seek peace, that the leaders of our country may pursue justice, righteousness, and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the pandemic may come to an end, and that livelihood and common life may be resumed. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That all who are afflicted may be strengthened in illness and comforted in adversity, especially those like we lift up in our general prayers, Carolyn Weimert, Roy Kaiser Sr., and Jeff Wagner. For our shut-ins and those others, Shirley Biondi, Jill Isansi, Connie Hine, Mr. Dick McBee, Bob Springer, Dolores Steinhilber, Reverend Steve Updegrave, and Dan Waltz. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the faithful may not fret what we do not know, but rejoice in Christ our Savior and live in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may grant us joyful hearts and peace at the last, knowing that neither death nor life nor any powers can separate us from the love of God in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may be generous in our tithes and offerings as the Lord is in giving us his gifts, that we may support the poor and those in need. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may know the Lord's presence in the means of his grace, hearing his word, receiving his absolution, and feasting at his table with faith and joy in our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may remember the saints of old who contended for the Lord in their own day, and that we may join them at last in the marriage feast of the Lamb without end. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
All these things and whatever else we need, we ask you to grant us for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, is one God, now and forever. Amen. Dear friends, this is the time in our liturgy for our offering and friendship folders. We really appreciate and thank you for the generous giving that we are receiving, and we draw your attention to our online friendship folders. Please take a minute to use those, say hello to us, request any prayers you might have. That information helps us better serve you. If you need help with making your online donations, please call the church office and speak with Miss Andy Proctor. She will walk you through that process. But again, we thank you and we hope your ministry of tithing is a blessing. The offertory, what shall I render to the Lord?
Oh,
As taught by our Lord, we're bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction of Aaron, the priest of Moses. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Dear friends, we are again so glad that you're able to worship with us. We hope this worship service has been a blessing. Please be with us this coming Wednesday, and next Sunday we'll be celebrating Pentecost. It's a great season. It's the birth of the church. So now go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Father's Song.
Singing over me, the
magnify this song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of Love has sent for me. And now you're singing over me, the Father's song.